After a painful night full of nightmares, I wake up in cold sweat, and my body feels like it's been battered by pro fighters. Pro fighters all day long. I try to inhale, but my throat feels like it's been ground with sandpaper. Oh, crap, why now? I cough violently and feel drained of energy. I rest my head against the pillow and try to open my eyes, but my eyelids feel incredibly heavy. This is bad. I promised Sayori I'd spend the day with her. As it stands, I don't even have the strength to reach out to my phone and call her. Even so, she needs to know, or she'll wait all day for me. I don't need to be a genius to know how badly she will take it if I don't show up without an explanation. I try to force my body to move enough to reach my phone, but it's futile. I feel weak and tired. Even so, I have to force myself and bear the cold pain. I crawl like an oversized caterpillar to the edge of the bed and slap the phone down into my bedside, where it lands in my right hand. I quickly select Sayori from my contacts list and call her. Before long, I hear her cheerful but sleepy voice on the other end. Mikey, are you alright? It's still early morning. I'm sorry if I woke you up. I cough violently again. Oh dear, that sounded awful. Don't worry about me. I am sure it's just a cold. Is there anything I can do to help you? I'm just calling to say that my coughing is so bad that I don't even get a chance to finish my sentence before my finger slips and accidentally makes me end the call. Oh, fuck. Crap. My phone's almost dead as well. Man, be like every other teenager. Fucking, before you go to bed, just leave the phone in the charger. Jeez. At this rate, it'll run out of battery if I try to call her again. Oh, jeez. I close my eyes and feel another nightmare enveloping me. Wait, what? In it, I see Sayori standing on the school rooftop, tears streaming down her face. She takes a step forward and... Well, I reach out to her and grab her by the arm before she can jump off. Oh, God, that's the worst nightmare. Just as I do, black mist covers everything, and the scene distorts. My eyes open, and I'm filled with anxiety. My eyes struggle to stay open for much longer. They close again, and I see Sayori sitting on the floor of her room, covering her face with her hands and crying loudly. In the dream, I try to walk up to her, only to find herself unable to move. I try calling out to her, but my voice is gone. Eventually, she gets up and shows me her face to reveal a pair of red eyes that burn with hatred for me failing her all these years. Just as she lunges at me with screams that she detests me from neglecting her years... here for years, the dream distorts and changes again. Oh my God. I find myself alone in the darkness. All I can hear is my own heartbeat. Oh Jesus! It's just all black and everything. Then suddenly I see Sayori walking towards me, asking me why I never supported her when she suffered, and why I only lived for myself. She then starts repeating the word why over and over again, before the voice magnifies and duplicates. Until there's an entire core asking me why I was such a terrible friend to her. I'm sorry. I hear myself pleading with the voices, but they don't let up. They start accusing me, pointing to the events in mine and Sayori's past where I could have helped her if I only knew of her condition at the time. Please forgive me. The voices are unfazed and say I don't deserve her kindness. Oh, God. I wake up completely drenched in cold sweat, yet again. How long did we sleep for? It seems like the shock of the last dream caused me to finally wake up. I feel tears running down my face, and my entire body keeps switching between burning hot and freezing cold. As I breathe in relief for a moment and think about how horrible my predicament was, I realized that all my dreams were exclusively about me and Sayori. It's then that I hear the sound of footsteps down below. Cold horror grabs me as I realize that I forgot to lock the door last night before crashing into bed. Really? The footsteps are coming closer. Whoever my intruder may be, they are clearly coming towards me. It's probably Sayori. I know I'm defenseless in my current condition. There's no hope for me to escape either. I see my doorknob turning. My heart is beating furiously as I try to come up with a means of escape. It's then that I hear a familiar voice call out to me. Mikey? Yep, it's Sayori. I sigh in relief as I see Sayori enter my room, carrying a tray with some tea. Aw, what a sweetheart. Says Sayori? I'm sorry, I didn't mean to enter your house without asking you, but luckily you forgot to lock the door last night. I only blink at her in confusion. Did I startle you? I'm so sorry if I did. I shake my head and she sighs in relief. Just what are you doing here? How and why? I was worried about you. You sounded quite sick. Sayori. As I look at her, my head is overwhelmed with all kinds of thoughts and feelings. Please don't tell me to leave. I won't. I clench my fist. I know she speaks the truth. Even if I had the strength to force her away. Oh, man. I know Sayori can be stubborn as a mule when she wants to. I've already called Monica and your home teacher too, telling them both you're sick. Come to think of it, I notice she's not in her school uniform. She seems to have made a decision to skip school today to take care of me. Oh, that's so nice. I wish I had a girlfriend that'd do that. I mean, that would probably affect their grades, but that's still cute. And what about you? Won't you get an absence?
Don't worry about me. I lied and told them I was feeling sick as well.
Why?
I want to be with you. You have nobody to take care of you, right?
Yeah, where the fuck is my guy's parents? Yeah.
Then it's settled. Just like you won't abandon me because of my condition, I won't leave you until you're recovered.
Please go home. I don't want you to get sick as well.
No, no can do. Besides, I won't get sick. I just have to believe that really hard and I'll be okay.
Or be A-okay. And, well,
taking care of you makes me happy.
I don't know whether it's from my temperature or my awkwardness at the situation, but I feel my cheeks turning red hot. I appreciate Sayori. I'm a lucky guy to have a great friend like you. Sayori says nothing, but she seems to appreciate the compliment.
Let's not joke around now. Just trust me. I'll make you feel better.
She walks over to me, sits down on her chair near my bed, and puts a hand on my forehead.
Okay.
She gently begins running her fingers down my neck.
I see.
Sayori? She sighs.
Thank goodness.
Hello, Eric to Sayori. She snaps out of her trance and sighs.
You have a fever, but it doesn't seem all too serious. Give it a few days and you'll be back to normal.
Is she a nurse? I throw her a heavily confused look and keep opening and closing my mouth like a dazzled carp.
I just read a lot of books about medicine when I'm alone. Because of, you know.
Oh. I nod without saying anything.
Anyway, just drink this for now.
She pours some tea into a cup and hands it to me. It's hot to the touch. And I nearly drop it as soon as I take a hold of it. Eventually, I manage to put the liquid to my lips and gulp down these few sips. This is really taste. No sooner do I speak than a terrible burning notion fills my throat. I cough violently and spill the tea over my bedsheets. fire. There's a fire in my throat.
I'm sorry. Did I make it too strong?
I merely nod. What the heck did you put in it?
Well, the book I read said that ginger tea works when you have a sore throat. So I looked through the fridge and found a bunch of ginger.
I feel nervous. Sweat rolled down my back. Fear grips me as I realize what she did.
How much of that did you put in that tea? An entire root?
That doesn't sound right. Even though I'm in clear pain, I know that Sayori only wanted to help. The problem is that I was planning to throw the ginger away since it was past its expiration date. Oh, God. Sayori realizes that she made a mistake, and I can see her smile slowly fading and that her eyes are starting to darken. Oh, no.
I'm sorry, I tried to help, but of course I messed up.
She speaks in a much lower, harsher tone than I've ever heard her before. Well, I appreciate it nonetheless.
Mikey, I'm sorry. Maybe I should leave. I only made this worse.
As she is about to get up, and I grab her hand. This gesture surprises her enough to make her hesitate, and I see her look down on me with an indescribable look in her eyes. Please don't leave. My voice is barely stronger than a whisper at this point.
Why? I'm just a nuisance.
She also lowers her voice and bites her lip to prevent herself from crying again.
I tried to help you, but I only made you feel worse, like always.
I shake my head.
Mikey, I want you to
stay.
Even if I'm useless? Even if I can't help you, since I know almost nothing about how to treat illness and I am so clumsy that I somehow end up making things worse?
I try to nod. Yes. The day has only just begun. We can still make it great. Sayori gasps and sits down. I look up, and judging from her expression, my words seem to have struck a chord in her heart. You can help me, just like I can help you. She says nothing. She's clearly in deep thought. Sayori?
How can I help you, Mikey?
Well, for starters, I need some painkillers, but I can't get up. But more than that, I hear that people recover faster when they're happy.
Oh, right. Sorry.
She dashes off after I describe to her where to find the painkillers and returns less than a minute later with the glass of water and the medicine. After I gulp it down to douse the fire in my chest and ease my overall pain, I lie down. Neither of us speaks, but even with my eyes closed, I can feel that Sayori keeps her gaze locked on me. All of a sudden, she breaks the silence.
I'm sorry if I got all negative there. I really don't know what came over me. It's just like this voice in my head keeps telling me I'm useless and worthless whenever I mess up.
Aww. I turn to face her, smile weakly, and stroke her hand with my fingers. Then we've just got to make it shut up. We kill it! That's not possible. If you can't do anything against it, I'll give it a go when I get better.
Why? Why are you doing this?
Why not? I could ask you the same thing right now. Why didn't you head to school when you heard I was sick?
You're my best friend. How could I let you suffer alone? I know that you have nobody else to take care of you right now.
I nod. Wouldn't you say you deserve the same kind of treatment? Sayori falls silent. Sayori?
I don't know. I really don't know. Do I really deserve that?
What do you mean?
She
seems to have a hard time finding the courage to put her feelings into words.
You know, you can tell me anything. I don't if I'm ready to tell you yet. I'm...
Wait, there's something she still didn't tell me yet? I wonder if it's her loving me. That could be it. It sounds like she's in pain. Whatever is the reason for her mindset seems to be really personal to her. But on the other hand, this might be my only chance to find out the root of the problem. If I could learn what made her think this way, I could do something to help her. However, Sayori might break under pressure. I can see she wants to tell me, but please don't push yourself. Please tell me what happened. Oh, shit. I don't know about this choice. Because, I mean, you don't want to push them to say it. At all, but you also want to know what's happening. We need another save. I'm about to say, please tell me what happened, because we need to know. We really need to know. I feel like if we tell her to don't push herself, she's not going to tell us, and I think it might drive her to end it. I'm sorry, but I can't. I want to, I really do, but it's too hard for me. Alright, I'm sorry, I don't want to force you. Change the subject. I feel like that's bad. Hold up. We need to go back. I'm sorry. It's not that I don't trust you, and I know you, of all people, deserves to know, but I silently nod. I won't deny that I want to know. But you look really uncomfortable. This is clearly important to you, and I don't want you to force yourself to confess it if you feel you're not ready. I can and will wait, because I'm serious about wanting to help you. But for that to happen, I need to know why you think you have no worth. Maybe that one was a better choice. I don't know, though. Thanks, I really appreciate it. She sighs and shakes her head again. I wish this wasn't so unfair. I'm not going anywhere, Sayori. I know. I promise I'll tell you when I'm ready. I feel my painkillers taking effect and my vision is getting blurry. So the medicine is starting to take effect? Yeah. Good, take a nap. I'll wait for you to wake up. Maybe then I'll have the courage to tell you. Oh. Her voice grows more and more distant as my fatigue catches up to me and drags me into a dreamless sleep. Oh, thank God for those fucking nightmares again. Before long, I start to hear two voices, a boy and a girl's. Oh, never mind. About to hear something. However, I see nothing, and the voices sound like they're old recordings that are played from a broken tape. Hey, what's wrong?
Oh, it's nothing.
Huh?
What happened to your knee? I fell. I bruised myself and my stuffed toy.
Wow, its neck is broken.
Sniffle.
Hey, please don't cry.
He was my only friend.
Your only friend?
Uh-huh.
Fuck.
Now what am I gonna do?
Let's go. I think we can fix him.
Really?
No sooner do I become aware of the meaning of the voices than they fade away, leaving only static noises in their place. Huh. That's weird. I wonder if that was... my character and Sayori as, like, kids. Because they're childhood best friends, right? I would have to assume. I wake up with a strangely present nostalgic feeling in my chest. My fever feels slightly less severe, and I feel enough energy to move my body around a little bit, though I'm still in pain. I look at my alarm clock, judging from the time, I must have slept for a good 6 hours. I notice that Sayori's gone. Sayori! Was it just a dream that she came over to take care of me? It better not have. No, it felt way too real to be a dream. As I wonder about the validity of my memories, I hear extremely loud off-key singing coming from downstairs, followed by a loud crash. That could only be one thing. The clumsy Sayori. Sayori's trying to cook. Oh no, she's gonna burn the house down! Oh no! Nope! 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 She's gonna burn the house down again! The end is nigh. The singing soon becomes even louder, and I realize that she's on her way. Wait, what? Oh my god, she didn't burn the house down. Whew! I rise up and smile at her as she enters the room. Oh, you're up. How are you feeling? Compared to how I felt this morning, I feel a lot better. I'm so happy to hear that. Sayori is practically beaming from the news as she sits down on the chair next to me. You looked really peaceful when in your sleep. Yeah, I had a nice dream. We didn't even know what the dream even was. I don't really remember the details, though. That's good to hear. What's up? He takes a deep breath. About what I said before you went to sleep, I've been thinking, and I want you to know. Oh, she's actually going to tell us about something she didn't tell us about. Even if I'm scared, but I know I can't keep running away from my problems. You're not alone, Sayori. There's nothing that can make me change my mind. Well, this is going to be a long story. Don't fall asleep, okay? I'll be really upset if you do. Don't worry, I'm wide awake, as you can see. She nods in acknowledgement and looks for words before she begins. I've always thought that I couldn't really matter. After all, how can somebody matter more than others? Aren't we all the same? You probably know this by now, but I never really had any friends when I grew up, until I met you, that is. I remember you were always afraid I'd leave you behind, or something like that. She nods. Yes, well, I've always been aware of how selfish people are. It's wrong that so many people just live for themselves, even though we call it a society. I don't want to be like that. I want to make other people happy, especially those who suffer.
Is that why you got so attached to me when we were kids?
I won't deny it's at least part of the reason. Or it was at first, anyway. Wanting to help others is fine, but sadly, I didn't think about how the selfish people would treat me. No matter how much I tried to help them, they weren't satisfied. They wanted more.
Aw, selfish sons of bitches.
Worse, when I was done helping them back up, they'd often leave me behind.
Aw, poor Sayori.
She suppresses the sob and wipes her tears away. Eventually, I started to get tired. They never showed any gratitude, and once they saw any signs of weakness in me, they turned against me.
Aww.
None of my friends cared enough to think about how much it hurts to always smile and stay positive every day. But if I didn't, they'd leave me. They'd spread rumors. They'd shut me out of their lives. That's why...
Before she could finish, I gather my strength and hug her tightly.
Mikey?
I'm not like those people, Sayori. I never exploit you for your kindness, and more importantly, I pull slightly away from her, just enough to see her face. I will never betray you like that. Her voice lowers down to a whisper.
Mikey,
Even if I'm your only friend, you're not alone. I'm about to say something else when I realize our faces are only inches away from each other. Just a little closer, and we'd be kissing. Oh my god!
Sayori notices this too and looks away in embarrassment. We break apart, with both of us apologizing at the same time. I lie down again, and she continues her story.
That's why I was so afraid to tell you or anyone else. As for why I feel like I'm worthless, it's like there's some voice inside my head telling me that if I don't satisfy anyone, I don't deserve anything good.
Wow. But you know that's not true.
I don't know. I don't know anything anymore. I don't know if it was a good idea for me to ask you to join the literature club. I don't know if it was a good idea for me to tell you. I don't know. I'm so scared of losing you.
Oh, poor Sayori.
She had such a bad life. Jeez.
I mean, I know this is like a mod and this is probably really not canon, but this is really fucking sad. You won't lose me.
You don't understand. Even if you're here with me, you'll just end up finding someone.
Finding someone? Wait, is she...
I shouldn't feel this way. It's wrong.
Is she about to say it? It's not wrong. Sayori.
I've gotten so used to always being left behind or exploited. I can't even imagine a happy future. I don't deserve it.
You deserve happiness. You won't be exploited or left behind. I really admire you. It takes guts to keep smiling after all you've gone through and still keep helping people. But you need to realize how much you're worth to me, Sayori. Shit. You're the only reason I made it this far. An idea suddenly forms in my head. You remind me of a certain character in an anime that I really love and admire. Do you want to watch it with me?
Okay, if that's what makes you happy.
I nod and ask her to leave the room while I change out of my pajamas. Oh. 5 minutes later, I call her back in and find a DVD in my drawer. She puts it in the TV and we start watching. The heroine of the anime is very much like Sayori. She is selfish to a fault, but keeps getting into trouble all the time because of it. Much like Sayori, she tries to face all her enemies alone, and while she succeeds in overcoming many of them, the final trial is impossible to solve alone. She nearly dies as despair overcomes her. But finally, her friends reach out to her and help her realize how much she is truly worth. The heroine ends up becoming a stronger person and overcoming the final enemy in the series, a being formed from humanity's despair. By the time we finish watching the anime, the sun has already gone down. I keep an eye on Sayori all throughout the anime. I need to... Okay. Nothing new. I haven't checked my phone in a while, so... I keep an eye on Sayori. Oh yeah, I read that part. She clearly seems moved at the end. It's only when the final episode ends that she speaks up.
Wow, she's so cool and strong.
Indeed she is. She's someone I've idealized since I was a kid.
I wish I could be like that.
You already are. Few people are willing to go to such lengths to help their friends without asking for anything in return. Silent. You can't give up because I'll be lost without my friend. But I don't want you to keep thinking you don't deserve my friendship. You deserve that and so much more.
Please,
Do you know why I respect that character so much? Because she's not afraid to be herself. She's a good person, and that is her main source of determination throughout the series. Yes, there will always be people who will want to exploit you for your selfless kindness. But there will also be people who care about you and who love you for your actions. You're not worthless because you're doing so much to help. Not just me, but the way you stopped Yuri and Natsuki from fighting the other day and how you always try to be as kind as possible to everyone you meet. If someone acted that way towards you, would you go as far as to call them worthless as well?
No, I wouldn't. I feel happy that they are so kind to me.
That's how you make me feel every day.
Mikey, she bites her lip and looks at my alarm clock. It's late. Maybe we should eat. I have to go soon.
Sure, I'm getting hungry. I'm sorry if I made you feel awkward.
Don't worry, I appreciate hearing that I'm not worthless to you.
Oh, man. This is truly an adorable story right now. I really love this. Shout out to the mod creator for this. Sayori brings me a dinner that she made herself, and the two of us eat in silence.
Oh, God.
Once we're done eating, she wishes me a good night and returns home after promising to come back tomorrow. Somehow, having someone take care of me feels really nice. But could there be another reason for why I feel so warm inside of me when I think about her and how she came to take care of me?
Because you love her, goddammit!
Could it be because of her and not just her gesture of kindness? I fail to find the answer before I fall asleep.
Good morning, sleepyhead.
A young woman's voice breaks me out of my sleep.
Oh, hi, Sayori.
Came in here? I open my eyes to see Sayori standing over my bed, holding a steaming hot cup of tea in her hands.
Yet again!
I feel a faint smile creep up on my face upon seeing her.
Morning.
Well, it's technically afternoon, but you look so peaceful in your sleep that I couldn't bring myself to wake you up.
She puts the cup of tea down on my nightstand and feels my forehead.
How are you feeling?
I try to reply, but my cough is still pretty violent. Sayori sighs deeply, clearly disappointed with herself.
I was hoping you'd feel better.
I do. It just takes a while to recover. I look directly at her. How about you, Sayori? She smiles a radiant smile.
I told you yesterday, don't worry about me. I'm tougher than I look. Besides, I'm here because I want to take care of you.
She mutters the last line to herself, her voice sounding more distant as she does.
Sayori?
She notices the concern in my voice and shakes it off.
It's nothing. I was just talking to myself is all. I guess I'm weird like that.
I think it's kind of cute. She takes her hand off my forehead and backs away. Is it just my imagination, or does she tense up a few seconds after I call her cute?
Probably.
Usually girls don't like it when they're being called cute, and sometimes they just blush about it, so.
Anyway, I figured that since it's already past noon that I should wake you up. It won't do you any good if you sleep the entire day away.
Her expression darkens.
I speak from personal experience, after all.
Sayori's acting weird. Could this be her depression acting up again?
Oh, no.
Sayori, something wrong. She shakes her head and smiles brightly.
No, it's nothing. I just feel a little tired, I guess.
Wait.
Did she already say that before?
Come to think of it, I did read that people suffering from depression often have sleep issues.
Yeah. Usually they do.
I think I should feel well enough to get up. You can go home if you want to rest.
No, please don't.
The desperation and fear in her voice is enough to make me flinch. She tries to smile, but I can tell from her eyes that she's scared of something. Sayori, please tell me what's wrong.
Nothing's wrong. Everything's all good.
Sayori. She clenches her fist.
Please, Mikey, just focus on your own recovery, okay? You worrying about me makes me feel really uncomfortable. I want to help others, but please don't worry about me.
I shake my head and tell her
that I can't do that. Why? It should be easy enough. You could just continue doing like you've always done. It's not that simple. A friendship is a mutual relationship. Upon hearing the words mutual relationship, Sayori seems to hesitate for a second. Huh. Hell, what's going on? However, she regains her composure almost instantly and takes the cup of tea in both her hands. Anyway, just drink this up. I made it less intense than yesterday. And please, don't tell me to leave. I sigh. Sure, I mean, I only said that out of concern since you seem tired. She falls silent and makes it clear she won't reply until I drink the herbal tea she brewed. With a sinking feeling of defeat, I put the cup to my lips and slowly make small gulps to drink up the steamy hot tea. Jesus! Can't read today. Just like Sayori said, it's less intense. I feel revitalized? What the hell? As soon as it flows into my stomach. Sayori takes my cup, but instead of leaving the room, she sits down on the chair near my bed. Mikey, are you afraid of being left behind? Being all alone in the world? Huh? No, never mind. I forget I said anything. I must be really tired if I'm rambling stuff like this right now. No, it's a perfectly legit question. I was just put off on it by how sudden it was. To be honest, I guess I haven't given it much thought. Sure, I would hate to be all alone in the world, but there's no reason for me to fear that since I have you as a friend. We'll always stick together since I know you're dependable.
I don't know about that, but I guess you have no reason to fear being left behind.
Sayori falls silent and turns her head away from me. It's clear that she's hiding something, but I can't imagine what. Sayori, did something happen?
It's nothing. You don't have to worry about it.
Jeez.
Just forget I said anything. It's nothing you need to worry about right now. Your recovery is more important. I'm an idiot for even bringing that up now.
Judging her from her voice, she's trying to fight back her tears. She gets up from the chair, and starts leaving, still wearing a bright smile on her face. I won't allow this. Sayori, wait. I gather my strength and get out of bed.
Mikey, no, get back. You're still too weak.
I ignore her and walk up to her. She shows no sign of running away. She only stands and looks at me with a bewildered expression on her face. Before she could back off, I put my arms around her.
Mikey? You big dummy.
Hey, only Natsuki calls me dummy. What the hell? Tears started rolling down her face. You know you can't. You can trust me. I mean, you already told me about your depression. She wipes her tears away and looks at me with a calm, serious look on her face.
Mikey, please let go of me. You shouldn't waste your time trying to help me solve my own issues.
Her voice is usually sharp and harsh.
But wait, you're trying to take care of me, though. Isn't that also wasting your time?
Despite this, I defiantly shake my head. I won't do that, Sayori. I turn my head away and let out a violent cough before continuing. Oh, jeez. Like family to me. Maybe even more. Oh. Sayori.
I'm hungry. If you can stay out of bed, it means we can go downstairs and eat.
Oh. Okay, but I want you to tell me what's wrong. She nods silently.
Okay, but I'm warning you. It's not a happy story.
Oh, no. We're about to get emotional up in this shit. Oh, man. Not again. That's fine by me. If anything, at least sharing it with someone is better than keeping it all to yourself, especially if it's something that bothers you. Isn't that what friends are for? She doesn't reply and merely pushes me away before going downstairs. God damn. After making sure she can't
see me anymore, I quickly change out of my pajamas and into my casual clothes. I then head downstairs, my heart pounding for some reason. As soon as I enter my kitchen, I see Sayori sitting by the table. The music's been silent for a good while now, so something's bound to happen. I mean, she's probably going to tell us the story of whatever's going on with her. I see fresh slices of bread and two boiled eggs lying nearby. Sayori must have bought and prepared them while it was out cold. Her expression is solemn and distant, as it seems like she's lost in thought. She doesn't even notice me until I call out to her. First, let's eat. You need to eat to regain the energy you lost. Alright. Did you prepare all this? Yes, I wanted to make breakfast for you. Feeling touched by her kindness, I quickly dig in, and true to her word, I feel my strength returning. Despite my illness, my appetite seems to be unaffected. It's only when I finish eating that I notice Sayori hasn't even touched her share, and has been staring at me with a curious expression on her face this whole time. Not hungry? It's fine. I don't really feel like eating right now, Aunt. Don't worry. Well, I guess there's no way you'll let me go without learning why I fear abandonment, huh? I shake my head. I'm here for you, Sayori. If you're unhappy and I know it, how can you expect me to be happy? You're too kind to me. I don't deserve that. She closes her eyes and sighs. Then she begins her tale. As she does... Okay, music's coming back. It's depressing, so... I'm waiting. My heart is waiting to be broken. Any minute now. As she does, her voice sounds cold and emotionless, as if she's reading out a script without putting much thought into words. As you know, I've always put others before myself. It's mainly because of my personal beliefs. I don't want to be selfish and hurt others, even if the selfish way... if the selfish way seems to be the best way to survive. As I grew up, I had to see so many people perform selfish acts just to make themselves happy. In kindergarten, one of my friends wanted a doll another girl had, so she stole it from her. When the girl wasn't watching, I knew what she did, but I kept silent and kept silent to not betray my friend. I acted selfish because I didn't want to lose someone who was precious to me at the time. Eventually, my friend pinned the blame on me to avoid getting into trouble. The girl she stole from hated me for it. And I could feel how much she hated me. Ever since then, I promised myself that I'd do everything I could to make others around me happy, no matter what. She falls silent and tears start rolling down her face. I try to get up, but she notices this and makes a gesture towards me that makes it clear that she wants me to stay. After a few sobs, she regains her composure and continues her tale. At the age when children attend elementary school, they become selfish. The other kids in my class noticed I couldn't do anything to defend myself since that mean hurting them physically or emotionally. So they started to force me to do various favors for them.
Oh, she got used. Oh, man. Again, though? I think everyone's been using her. That's really sad.
I did as they told me, since I wanted to make everyone happy. One of them, a boy in my class, seemed to genuinely care about me. He always defended me whenever they lashed out at me if I disappointed them. Eventually, I guess I got a crush on him and devoted myself to making him happy.
So, if she's telling us that she had a crush on him, because she was taking care of, or like caring about him too much, doesn't that already make it obvious that she's
Well, I mean, it's already obvious, but... But, I mean, isn't that basically what she's saying? Is that... That she has a crush on me and she... Keeps making him happy and whatnot?
I would buy him sweets after school and even do his homework in his stead. No matter how much it tired me out.
That's a little too much, though, Sayori. What the hell? So far, that is.
All to make him happy, since I was secretly, selfishly hoping that he would like me back. It was only after 4 years that I found out he only used me.
4 years?! Used by the same guy for 4 years. I have never heard anybody get used for that long. Oh my god.
He never valued me as a person, and once I started to show clear signs of exhaustion, he started to mock me and call me weak and useless.
Piece of shit.
He even spread horrible rumors when I wasn't looking, and slowly but surely destroyed my reputation to the point where I feared going back to school every day. Even after I learned what he did behind my back, I couldn't hate him. When he asked me for forgiveness, I forgave him immediately.
Bad choice. Jeez, what an asshole. Sayori smiles bitterly and bites her lip.
If only he was the only one, and if only the story ended here. One day he announced to me that he got a girlfriend, and who'd have thought it was the same girl whose doll he had been stolen.
What a coincidence.
The two of them ganged up on me, telling me such awful things. How I'm nothing more than a tool. How I don't deserve friends and love. How I'm worthless. Aw, poor Sayori. They were so persistent. I started to believe them, and still do. After all, this is my fault. If I hadn't been so selfish in my desire to make others happy, then maybe...
She breaks down into a series of hysterical sobs. I walk over to her and hug her, letting her cry into me. Sayori, listen to me. I won't abandon you. I'm not like those assholes. I value you as a person. Not for what you do, but for who you are.
But I'm so scared. What if you end up finding someone better?
Aw. Never, Sayori. God. There really isn't any question of me finding someone better. Even if I did get other friends, I would still never abandon you like that. As for you thinking you're worthless, you're not. Definitely not. You're worth so much to me. And you're much better than that than you think you are. Isn't the fact that I'm standing here with you proof of that fact? Proof of that fact. I don't know if that's a typo or not, or I'm just really bad with English. If I haven't abandoned you when you're at your lowest point, you don't have to worry about me abandoning you in the future. Besides, as someone who's been abandoned by several friends and treated like a walking joke for most of his life, I know how you feel. I feel her grip tighten, and for a while, I just let her sob into me while I gently stroke her. Eventually, she calms down and sighs.
I'm sorry you had to see that.
I don't mind. I'm happy. Now I know more about you, Sayori. I'm happy you're my friend, and helping you makes me happy as well. I don't know if it's just my imagination or not, but she feels warmer all of a sudden.
Thank you. You have no idea how much this means to me.
Just know that you're not alone anymore. You don't have to face all your inner demons alone. I see her bright smile return.
Okay, I trust you. How weird.
What's up?
This warmth I feel oddly relieved at having told you.
I'm glad you're feeling better.
Hey, that's my line. Don't forget I came here to take care of you, not the other way around.
Haha. How could I ever forget? But you can talk to me anytime, Sayori. No matter how big or small the problem is, if you have concerns, you know I'm there for you, like you are for me.
I know, and I appreciate that so much. But I'm still afraid. I don't want to be a burden.
You were never a burden to me. Since we're in the mood of confessing awkward things, I guess I should mention that without you in my life, I'd be completely alone. Nobody else takes me seriously. I doubt even my parents see me as anything other than a big doofus. Wow, even your parents are a dick? God damn, that's some really shitty parents. But you always take me so seriously and always treat me with respect. I owe you a lot more than I let on, you know?
You're too kind. Hey, let's just end this now. I feel like my heart is going to burst if we don't change the topic soon enough.
Aw, poor Sayori. She loves this. I thought you know. Loves feeling like that, I guess. Like, always feeling the heart pumping because she's feeling really loved and not alone and everything. Alright, what do you want to do?
Please let me go back to taking care of you. I really enjoy it. I love the feeling of being useful to you.
I let out a dejected sigh. Okay, fine. As I get up and I'm about to leave for my room, she calls out to me.
Also, Mikey?
She smiles at me.
Thanks again. Talking to you always makes me feel happy.
Or feel so happy. I merely smile in response and head upstairs.